cases.
Well, joining me now is Dr. Andrew Foxall, Director of the Russia and Eurasia Studies Department at the Henry Jackson Society. Who are these men, do you think?
It seems possible that they are indeed GRU officers, as UK intelligence holds at the moment. And that's intelligence, of course, that's been backed and supported by our Western allies and to some degree by the OPCW, where their activities in the UK were concerned. Now, if, however, they are civilians, as President Putin argued today, and not GRU military intelligence officers, then what that does is open up the possibility that the Metropolitan Police may go to Moscow to interview them, just as they did in 2006 when members of the Met Police went to Moscow to interview the two key suspects, Andrei Lugovoy and Dmitry Kovtun, in relation to the poisoning of Alexander Litvinenko. But we must bear in mind, of course, that when the Metropolitan Police did go to Moscow to investigate the poisoning of Litvinenko, they themselves were poisoned, which suggests to me that any Russian offer for coordination or collaboration in this investigation isn't really worth the paper that it may be written on. Mm.
And if we do take what you are assuming and what a lot of other people in the intelligence community assume, that these two men are in the GRU, are in Russia's military intelligence, or are former GRU officers, why is President Putin now saying, oh, we found them, we know who they are? Why not just keep quiet?
Well, the timing of it is interesting, as you say. It comes a day into a significant economic forum, that's taking place in Vladivostok in eastern Russia, that is being attended by President Xi and a number of other significant leaders from East Asia. And that is an opportunity for Putin to wine and dine them in an attempt, in a sense, to attract money from them to prop up Russia's stagnating economy. But as your question suggests, the Putin's comments today are a significant departure from what Russia has been saying thus far. What it's been saying thus far is, first of all, that Russia didn't have anything to do with the events in Salisbury and Amesbury. But if it did, any evidence that the UK has produced has been fabricated. In a sense, we didn't do it, but if we did, you're telling lies. It seems to me, as I say, that one reason for this is the timing of it. But exactly what happens from here, whether or not we will hear from these individuals next week or whether or not they may simply appear in the Russian parliament, as Andrei Lugovoy did, appointed in a sense a politician in 2010, remains to be seen.
Do you think further sanctions are possible or necessary against Russia?
I think individual bilateral sanctions from the UK toward Russia are unlikely at the moment. As with everything else, it's easier for other countries to undertake actions when the United States leads. The United States did impose additional sanctions in August that related to Russia's use of Novichok in both Salisbury and Amesbury. And those are sanctions which will be ratcheted up every 90 days or so until Russia, first of all, admits that it used Novichok and then undertakes measures in a sense to get rid of its supplies. Now, that seems to me to be unlikely. So, as I say, there are additional US sanctions and they will continue. But the issue at the moment, of course, with any unilateral sanctions from the UK is that our sanctions regime is currently tied with that of the European Union. And there seems to me to be very little appetite within the EU to announce additional sanctions on Russia.
And they seem to have a lot on their mind as well at the moment, don't they? Dr. Andrew Foxall, thank you very much.